Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our worship this Sunday, this fourth Sunday of Advent, the last Sunday before Christmas. We're so happy that you're here, whether you're with us live on Sunday morning or if you are watching this recording later. We are grateful to you for worshiping Christ the Lord with us. Take just a moment now in quiet to invite the Holy Spirit to be present with you. And if you want to light a candle or otherwise mark this time as a holy time, you can do that.
Well, we could have done five candles.
I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to his word.
O come, let us worship.
Dear friends in Christ, as we prepare to worship Almighty God, let us with penitent and obedient hearts confess our sins, that we may obtain forgiveness by his infinite goodness and mercy.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness and keep you in eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Lord, open our lips.
And our mouth shall proclaim your praise.
O God, make speed to save us.
O Lord, make haste to help us. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Alleluia.
Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word.
We light this candle in prayer for Christ's daily visitation, that his love may so fill us up, it bursts forth into the world.
We sing A Candle is Burning as we light the four candles of Advent. And now let us join in singing our opening hymn, My Lord, He is a-comin soon. Pray the Magnificat, Canticle 18a, taken from the first chapter of Luke. My soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord. My spirit rejoices in God, my Savior, for he has looked with favor on his lowly servant.
From this day, all generations will call me blessed. The Almighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name.
He has mercy on those who fear him in every generation.
He has shown the strength of his arm. He has scattered the proud in their conceit.
He has cast down the mighty from their thrones and has lifted up the lowly.
He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent away empty.
He has come to the help of his servant Israel, for he has remembered his promise of mercy.
The promise he made to our forefathers, to Abraham and his children forever. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
I'd like to ask Louise to unmute herself at this time as we hear a reading from the second book of Samuel.
Now when the king was settled in his house, and the Lord had given him rest from all his enemies around him, the king said to the prophet Nathan, "See, now I am living in a house of cedar, but the ark of God stays in a tent." Nathan said to the king, "Go, do all that you have in mind, for the Lord is with you." But that same night, the word of the Lord came to Nathan, "Go and tell my servant David, thus says the Lord, are you the one to build me a house to live in? I have not lived in a house since I brought up the people from Israel, the people of Israel from Egypt to this day, but I have been moving about in a tent and a tabernacle. Wherever I have moved about among all the people of Israel, did I ever speak a word with any of the tribal leaders of Israel, whom I commanded to shepherd my people Israel, saying, why have you not built me a house of cedar? Now, therefore, thus you shall say to my servant David, thus says the Lord of hosts, I took you from the pasture, from following the sheep to be over my people Israel, and I have been with you wherever you went, and have cut off all your enemies from before you, and I will make for you a great name, like the name of the great ones of the earth.
Something on the page.
The word of God. And I will appoint a place for my people Israel and will plant them so that they may live in their own place and be disturbed no more. And evildoers shall afflict them no more as formerly from the time that I appointed judges over my people Israel, and I will give you rest from all your enemies. Moreover, the Lord declares to you that the Lord will make you a house. Your house and your kingdom shall be made sure forever before me. Your throne shall be established forever." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Today we have a gradual hymn, The Angel Gabriel. Linda, to unmute as we hear a reading from the letter to the Romans.
Now to God, who is able to strengthen you according to my gospel and the proclamation of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery that was kept secret for long ages, but is now disclosed, and through the prophetic writings is made known to all the Gentiles, according to the command of the eternal God, to bring about the obedience of faith to the only wise God, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever. Amen. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And now please join in singing the gospel hymn, Mary, Did You Know? There's an extra verse at the end that you may not know, and it's Mary responding to the question. So it comes in with a little pause, and it's a little bit slower tempo when we get to it. You'll hear it as it comes through.
Sons and daughters, did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you delivered will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy would give sight to a
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary, and he came to her and said, "Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God, and now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David." He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end. Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I am a virgin?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called Son of God. And now your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month for her who was said to be barren. For nothing will be impossible with God." Then Mary said, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her. The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Thanks, everybody, for your patience as we have a slightly slow slideshow this morning. Mary, the mother of Jesus, has always been controversial. And it's for a very good reason. What on earth do you do with the mother of God? The very idea that God, creator and originator of all things, can have a mother much less a mother who is amongst his creation, is a conundrum. Christians have spent millennia arguing about how best to solve this conundrum. At different times and in different places, we have elevated Mary or have lowered Jesus, trying to understand the birth in time of the timeless Son of God. Trying to understand how the creator of the universe became a creature. Trying to understand how a human woman could bring forth from her body a savior who is Christ the Lord. Even Mary wonders at this fact. Her first response to the angel is, "How can this be?" But her wonder at the how does not prevent her from moving forward with the task at hand. We sing the song, "Mary, Did You Know?" But it is very evident in the scriptures that Mary did know what mighty acts of our salvation would be accomplished by the babe she carried in her body, by the child she cradled in her arms, by the boy she presented in the temple, by the man she watched die on a cross. Not least because of the song she sings upon receiving today's annunciation that she had been chosen to bear God's Son. The Magnificat, which we prayed in place of the psalm this morning, is the song Mary sings very shortly after receiving the angel's announcement in today's gospel. After the angel has departed from her, Mary sets out to visit her cousin Elizabeth, who is also experiencing a miraculous pregnancy. Elizabeth is older, much too old to expect that pregnancy would happen naturally. And anyway, after years of trying with no success, she and her husband, Zachariah, thought it was impossible. But as the angel says, Elizabeth is now pregnant with a child who will become John the Baptist. A child who leaps in her womb with joy to greet Mary, now pregnant with Jesus. And once the two women are together, Mary sings this song, which is nearly as controversial as she is. In colonial India, the British forbade it from being sung in churches. During the Dirty War in Argentina, the military junta banned it entirely because mothers of disappeared children had decorated the Capitol Plaza with its words. This song, Mary's rebel anthem, as one priest has called it, is not some buttoned-up, prim and proper church hymn for the practically perfect. It is a call for liberation. Words of hope, too dangerous for the ears of those who know perfectly well the effects of oppression they are inflicting upon a suffering people. This rebel anthem makes clear that Mary knew precisely how the paradoxical child she carried would shatter all the paradoxes and bring a new way of living, one might say, a new kingdom of heaven, which has drawn near to us. A kingdom which proclaims the greatness of God. When people hear of this kingdom, their first response to God's action in the world will be joy, not fear, not defensiveness, not shame, but joy, that the one who made all things has turned his gaze upon those who serve him, and his look is one of favor. God is coming to save us, and this salvation will cause all future generations, thousands of years from now, to pour forth blessing and honor and glory that God has rescued God's people from that which held us in bondage. And holy is God's name, holy because everlasting is his mercy, holy because he does not leave us in bondage, but comes down out from his heaven and makes himself vulnerable like us, makes himself vulnerable to us as a baby. This baby, this weak and fragile baby represents not God's weakness, but God's strength. Because with God, up is down and down is up, the strength and power and glory and might of humankind, of empire, is no strength at all. For with the birth of this tiny, vulnerable child, God has scattered all those puffed up with pride in the imagination of their hearts. God has cast them down from their thrones. God has lifted up the lowly. I want us to pay special attention to the verb tense here. Mary doesn't predict that God will do this at some future date. She doesn't prophesy that her son will grow up to be a mighty warrior who will ride the Romans out of town. Mary proclaims that God already has done this. It is accomplished. A preacher has written, prophets almost never get their verb tenses straight, because part of their gift is being able to see the world as God sees it, not divided into things that are already over and things that have not happened yet, but as an eternally unfolding mystery that surprises everyone, maybe even God, end quote. Of course, we look around us and see a world that doesn't look much like Mary's proclamation. We see a world where the proud puff themselves up in the imagination of their hearts, where the rich are filled with good things and the hungry are sent empty away. It is a conundrum. And it's no wonder that we, like the powerful whose ears cannot bear Mary's words, perhaps cast her voice as too much hope to bear in a world that feels so hopeless. But we serve a God who entered her body to make her song true. We serve a God who was willing to be crushed by the powers of this world, who gave up all his divine power and authority and emptied himself in order to make this song come true. And we who serve that God are called to live our lives as if it is true, to see with a prophet's eyes, to use a prophet's verb tenses, to sing boldly, even when we don't see it, that God has remembered God's promise of mercy, made hundreds of thousands of generations ago, and that even when all hope seems lost, God is coming to set the world to rights. So thank you, Mother Mary, for your song. Thank you for making your rebel anthem your son Jesus's lullaby. May we who pray it together live in the vision of truth it offers through Jesus Christ our Lord, who for our sake became poor. Amen. Let us now proclaim our faith in the God who is turning the world around, as we say.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven by the power of the Holy Spirit. He became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The prayers of the people. Let us offer our prayers to God, saying, Lord, look with favor on your servants. May our souls proclaim your greatness, O God.
Lord, look with favor on your servants.
May our spirits rejoice in your salvation, O God.
Lord, look with favor on your servants.
May your blessings upon us call us to bless all the nations of the earth throughout all generations, O God.
Lord, look with favor on your servants.
May your name remain holy on our lips, O God.
Lord, look with favor on your servants.
Have mercy upon those who fear you throughout the world, especially those who are persecuted for your name's sake, O God.
Lord, look with favor on your servants.
Show your strength, mighty one. Scatter the proud in the imagination of their hearts, O God.
Lord, look with favor on your servants.
Cast down those who count themselves mighty and lift up the lowly, O God.
Lord, look with favor on your servants.
Fill the hungry with good things, O God.
Lord, look with favor on your servants.
Inspire us who are rich to empty ourselves for the sake of the poor, O God.
Lord, look with favor on your servants.
Come to the help of your servant Israel, O God.
Lord, look with favor on your servants.
Remember your promise of mercy, especially to those who have asked us to pray for them. Lorraine, Anthony, Kathy, Peter, the victims of recent hate attacks here in Edmonton, those on our hearts and those known to you alone, O God.
Lord, look with favor on your servants.
Heavenly Father, who chose the Virgin Mary, full of grace, to be the mother of our Lord and Savior, now fill us with your grace, that we in all things may embrace your will and with her rejoice in your salvation. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
All right. Well, good morning again, and welcome to Good Shepherd Anglican Church here in Edmonton, Alberta, Canada, on the fourth Sunday of Advent, the final Sunday before Christmas. If you're visiting, we're happy that you're here. If you would, let us know in the chat that you're visiting today. We would love to welcome you during our fellowship time after the service. Make sure to subscribe to our weekly roundup in order to keep up to date with all of the news here at Good Shepherd. Before I make any other announcements, are there any birthdays or anniversaries to be blessed this week? Please do raise your hand or type in the chat or in otherwise let me know. I'm going to scroll through the videos here for just a second to see if there's any birthdays or anniversaries coming up. Oh, Gail, I'm seeing Gail.
I don't know how to type.
Hi, Faye.
Hi, guess what?
What?
It's Jack's birthday on December 24th.
It is Jack's birthday on December 24th. Gail says it's her birthday tomorrow. Uche says it's their 10th anniversary. And I also know that it's John Matthews' birthday on the 24th. So we'll have lots of blessings. Keep typing into the chat if you would, my friends, as the announcements go, and then we'll offer blessings at the end of the announcements. There are a lot today. So I do encourage you to pay attention because it's the week of Christmas. There's just a whole lot going on. It will be a very different celebration than we're used to. And we hope that you will join us in staying home, all ye faithful, to adore him, Christ the Lord. Rather than, O come, all ye faithful, we say, stay home, all ye faithful, to protect yourself, to protect others, which is the greatest commandment that Jesus gave us. We do have a number of offerings available this week to aid you in your devotions. First up, this Wednesday, December 23rd at 7 p.m., Talisa will be hosting a live Zoom carol sing. This is a casual and informal time of singing, and she will invite you to call out your favorite Christmas carols. And if she has got the music for it, she will try her best to offer them to you with her keyboard and her voice. You can sing along with your mic muted, or maybe we'll unmute and make it messy. I don't know. We'll figure it out. The Zoom link will be available at our website and in this week's weekly roundup. Also in the roundup this week, our digital Christmas pageant. Thank you to all of the families who submitted videos to Raylin. She is working hard at putting them together to share the story of Christmas with us. So make sure that you are subscribed to our weekly roundup, that it's not going to your spam folder. You're going to want to watch this video. On Christmas Eve, which is Thursday, we will gather via Zoom at 7 p.m. for a traditional-ish Christmas Eve service. We'll sing the favorite carols, we'll tell the story of Jesus's birth, and we'll pray for the world as we usually do. This is a BYO candles service. So if you would like to participate in the bit at the end where we all light a candle as we sing Silent Night, you will need to have your own candles available. We are not going to be able to hand it to you through the screen, unfortunately. This is a different link than our Sunday service. So please do check the weekly roundup and our website and make sure you click on the Christmas Eve Zoom link. On Christmas Day, we are meeting on Zoom for breakfast at the manger at 10:30 a.m. If your Christmas morning is feeling a little small and a little lonely, come share your breakfast with us in an informal time of fellowship, prayer, and singing. Talisa and her family will also be offering a free Zoom concert at some point that day, and details will be in the weekly roundup if you'd like to sign in for that opportunity. If Zoom isn't doing it for you, or if your family festivities preclude you from meeting at those times, also on our website is a suggested Christmas service that you can complete at home entirely by yourself with your household. It is available for download at our website. And if you would like one printed and delivered it to you, you must send me an email today to request it. Speaking of things that need to be emailed today, Christmas doesn't end on Christmas Day. Families are invited to keep the spirit of Christmas alive for 12 days of Christmas. Raylan has put together envelopes with suggestions for family fun for each day through to January 5th. If you would like for us to deliver these envelopes to your house, you must email Raylan by the end of the day today. Finally, I know it's been a lot, but I did want to let you know that next Sunday, December 27th, Bishop Jane has put together a service of Christmas lessons and carols for the entire Anglican Diocese of Edmonton. This pre-recorded service will be available for you to watch on the diocesan website, or you can log in here at our regular Sunday info, and our theological student, Brad Linseth, will share the service from his screen so that we can watch it together, almost like a watch party kind of a thing. So if that's something you would like to do to have community on Sunday the 27th, come here at 10:30 like you normally would, and Brad will make that possible for you. The office will be closed the week after Christmas so that our staff can take some well-deserved rest. Please do reach out to each other during that time. I'm so grateful that we're the kind of community that connects with one another in a social and fellowship kind of a way. The final evening prayer of the year will be this Tuesday, December 22nd, but morning prayer will continue Monday through Thursday, the week after Christmas. So if you're feeling alone this Christmastide and you need the opportunity to connect, morning prayer at 9 a.m. is a great way to do that. And you can find any Zoom links if you haven't joined before on our website or in the weekly roundup. I know there was a lot of announcements, but there are more in the weekly roundup, so please do keep your eye on it. Let's see, I've seen the chat is buzzing. So are there more birthdays, or is it just everybody wishing people a happy birthday? Oh, Bella says that it's Paul's birthday on the 22nd. So good Lord, we've got birthdays and anniversaries. Let's just offer prayers for all of them, shall we? Oh God, our times are in your hand. Look with favor, we pray, on your servants as they begin another year. Grant that they may grow in wisdom and grace, and teach them to trust in your goodness all the days of their lives through Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you now and remain with you forever. Amen. Happy birthday to Jack and John and Paul and Gail. Happy anniversary to Uche and Amaka. We are just so happy that you are a part of our community. We are grateful to everyone who continues to support us financially in this season. Whether you donate at the link listed on this slide or you mail in a check, we are grateful for your gift. And no matter when you offer it, know that the prayer over the gifts, which we will offer after we sing the offertory hymn, that prayer blesses your gift as well. I invite you now to join in singing our offertory hymn, What Child Is This? Let us pray. Gracious God, by the power of the Spirit who sanctified the mother of your Son, make holy all we offer you this day. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, the Lord.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
May Almighty God, by whose providence our Savior Christ came among us in great humility, sanctify you with the light of his blessing and set you free from all sin.
Amen.
May he whose second coming in power and great glory we await make you steadfast in faith, joyful in hope, and constant in love.
Amen.
May you who rejoice in the first advent of our Redeemer at his second advent be rewarded with unending life.
Amen.
And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you forever.
Amen.
Please now join in singing our ascending hymn, See Him Lying on a Bed of Straw.
Thanks be to God.